There's a funny note around Silicon Valley now where apparently 51% of companies are started by immigrant founders, a lot like us. And I'm wondering, you know, your story of arriving into the United States, you know, that the first early years of kind of getting to hacking are really interesting. And I think it really reflect a lot of how, especially Eastern European immigrants, get started here. And I wonder if you could tell us a little about those early years, what things were like when your parents came over, what was the struggle like, or did you, you know, get started immediately doing interesting things after getting your first computer around, say, 11?
Yeah, I mean, I think I had a pretty typical nerd childhood. I mean, I grew up mostly in the Bronx, so yeah, I was 8 years old when we came over, and I was in a pretty, grew up in a pretty rough neighborhood in the Bronx in the you know, late 70s, early 80s in New York. I, like, none of the gangs would have me, so I just stayed at home and, you know, learned computer stuff. Was lucky enough to get into Bronx Science, which is kind of one of the magnet schools in New York. So it's a public high school, but it's competitive admission. And I probably would have had a terrible time if I hadn't gotten in, because, like, I was, you know, pretty awkward, you know, socially, physically. My English was pretty bad until, you know, later on, because I didn't speak any English when I came over. But the high school I got into was just, like, you know, so nerdy that I fit in reasonably well. Yeah, just had a generally fortunate, you know, childhood. Started hacking around at an early age and kind of never stopped.
Yeah, and I remember, you know, reading that even then it didn't really feel like much of a challenge. You ended up going to school to dabble in business, but then switch over to computer science, and decided that wasn't really for you. Considering it was BU, I can see why. I'm a Northeastern guy, so we got to take a few swipes. There was a quote where you said you didn't feel like you were really average until you joined your first great technology company.
Yeah, I think I kind of, like, growing up, I always felt like I was pretty smart. You know, I was kind of, you know, didn't really know anything, but, like, I think a lot of kids that are, like, slightly above average intelligence, like, you just think we're, like, brilliant. So I always just assumed that I was, like, the smartest person anywhere, and I kind of got used to that. And, you know, that was true throughout most of school, most of college, and then I, you know, my first couple of jobs, because they were in, like, big companies. And then I got to this place in Boston called ATG, Art Technology Group. And all of a sudden, I was, like, barely adequate. I was, like, definitely below average. I was barely adequate. I was like, wow, what the hell just happened? Like, how, like, I don't understand. Like, did I have a stroke? Like how, what's going on? And at first, I was miserable about it, because I was, like, super nervous. I didn't know if I'd make it. And then I realized, like, fairly quickly, within a few days, I'm like, no, actually, this is, like, the secret of happiness, is to, like, always be the least interesting person in the room. So I've tried to optimize for that, but it was a super good experience, and I've kind of tried to replicate that every, you know, every other thing I've done, I've tried to, like, be the least interesting person in any room.
What was it about that team, the people, or that culture that you started to bring forward to your next businesses? What was it about it that made you feel like this is what life is about?
Well, so a big part of it was just, you know, it was just competence. Like, there are many most organizations of people, like, don't have competence as a virtue. They have all sorts of other virtues, but they're not trying to optimize for just, like, excellence. And that was the first time that I had been in a place where it was just like, yeah, you've got to be this good, or, you know, you don't get to be in it. And they just kept improving the performance, the quality, the competence, the excellence, and it was actually really challenging. And that just, you know, that was great. And I kind of realized that, you know, that feels a lot better than just feeling smugly superior to people. They had all sorts of other problems in the company. You know, didn't pay us and that kind of stuff, but they were really smart.
Sometimes the work is its own reward. Then right after that, you started a company called CoreStreet, doing sort of credentialing for governments and corporations. How did you go from, you know, highly competent, slightly problematic team to starting that? Did you have any runway too?
Yeah, so the first company we started was called Engine 5, and that was with a few friends of mine, but we were all working together. We were all in college together and then working together at our technology group. And then we decided to start our own company. And The idea there was purely a social experiment. We wanted to see if it was possible to start a company and not have any assholes in it, which has never been done, you know, before that in the history of companies. And we literally, like, that's what we wanted to do. We were like, well, can we start a company? And when someone shows up to interview and we kind of think that person's an asshole, we just don't hire them. And if it's like, why hasn't that been done before? Because we've never been at a place where that wasn't the case. So that's what we started with. And, you know, this was 1997. So all you needed to do was like know how to program and people would like give you money. It was right at the start of the dot-com bubble, the first one. And then we sold that, luckily, like 20 minutes before the bubble burst. It was just like the best good luck timing ever. And, you know, put in our 2 years at the acquiring company and then got out and decided to start the next one. And the second company, CoreStreet, that was just timing. So we started that on October 11th of 2001, which was a month after September 11th. And so I think back then everyone felt like we wanted to do something more consequential than, you know, before we were working on, you know, e-commerce, websites, just random tech. And a month after September 11th, I think the general feeling is like none of that stuff really matters. We want to do something consequential. And so we did this MIT spin out that was doing you know, cryptography and security because we thought that would make a difference.
And at those companies, you know, there was this is trend of these four people that ended up actually joining at Evernote and being the core team. And you kind of sort of met them along the way. Could you tell us about that core team? What were their qualities that eventually led them to be the co-founding team of Evernote?
Yes, Evernote actually has a pretty complicated starting history. There was actually two teams that came together in 2007 to found it, but I've been with a lot of the same people for a while now, since college, and every company we like pick up some people and we lose some people, and so there's like this, like, you know, a crew of 20, 30 people right now that I just like, I know I want to do every important thing with. They're not all the same people from college, but actually some of the people from BU are still like working with me now. And that was like really important, is this idea that you like cultivate a crew, like people that you trust, that you know are really good, and just do everything with them. I got this advice from Steve Ballmer. I like randomly reached out to him one day and said, hey, will you like answer some questions? So I asked him a bunch of stuff, but like the most important thing that he told me was he said, look, there's about 100 people in everyone's life. Like, you only get about 100 that are like the important people in your life. And every important thing you do with this 100 people. And once you've met these 100 people, like, you're done. Like, you can't, there's no more. Like, you only have room for 100. And he's like, most people like burn through the first 50 before they're out of college. And that's like a big mistake because you never get those slots back. So you just really want to be really mindful of like who is in that core, you know, 100 people. And everything you do with them. And hopefully you wind up working with some of them, but not all of them. And like, that's just how the world works. And I think I'm like much, much less gregarious than Steve Ballmer. So like, he may have 100, I've got like probably 12.
Quality over quantity.
Yeah, so I have to be very economical with those.
And so this is a tribe that you add to, subtract from over, you know, the period of your entire lifetime. What have you found?
Try not to subtract too much, but yeah.
Yeah. What are some common themes of the people? You know, you mentioned competence, that's a given. What are some of the other themes of these folks that you really retain in that 12 or 100?
Yeah, I mean, you know, just honesty. I mean, the most important is high bandwidth communication. Like, the thing that screws everything up is just miscommunication. So, you know, you find some people that you can just like, you just can know for a long time and you've never misunderstood each other. Like, you just always understand each other. Like, that's rare. And then there's other people that like every other thing you say that turns out it's like some kind of misunderstanding. So like, you can't deal with that. So it's, you know, it's just general goodwill and honesty and all that stuff. But lots of people have that. The thing that makes a crew unique is like very high bandwidth understanding. So you just, you know, you don't get your signals crossed. And that's like huge, especially for starting a new company. Like, I just know that my co-founders and I, like, yeah, we're not going to have random crazy misunderstandings. And that's vastly important.
Yeah, and so to continue this journey, to kind of set the stage here, you know, you've had the first exit, the finally CoreStreet exited as well, and you had gone through the motivation of, hey, let me start a company with my friends that won't have any troubles. You went through the motivation of, let me do something that will be impactful. And with Ribbon, and eventually Evernote, the motivation seemed to have been, let me do something for us. I was wondering if you could take us a little bit through that that founding story. It is a bit of a complicated one. When Ribbon was started, with a little bit of inspiration from sort of how your name is pronounced in Japan, to eventually sort of joining forces with Evernote. Could you tell us a little bit about how you found them and how that all worked?
Yeah. So the motivation for Evernote for us was definitely we wanted to do something for ourselves. Our previous two companies, we were building products for other types of people. Like the first one, we were doing e-commerce, and the second one, we were doing, you know, government security. And so we had to constantly like wonder, like, what does the customer want? What does the customer want? What does the customer want? We just got really boring. And so we said, all right, like the third time around, like, we don't care what the customer wants. We just want to do what we want. Like, let's just make something that we would fall in love with. And that was literally the motivation. So we sat around and we like made lists, like, well, what should we work on? What do we love? And like a lot of us love video games. And so I said, well, let's make a video game company. But then I thought, well, I already have this like giant stack of video games at my desk that I don't have time to play through. And the world already has a lot of great video games. So, you know, maybe we don't need another video game company. This was in 2007. And so then we said, well, we really like this new social media stuff. Like, maybe we should make a social network. And I'm like, yeah, but there's already MySpace, and no one can beat MySpace. So we like, we missed that opportunity.
So right.
So we didn't do that. And then we're like, well, what about like, you know, what about something in the productivity space, something that like makes us smarter? It was inspired by Dune, by the Mentats in Dune. Like, what if we can make something that like makes you a superhuman computer in your own brain? And we're like, yeah, like there's nothing in productivity that's any good. Like Microsoft Office is already like 30 years old. So let's do that. That's how we got to it. And then we met another team. We were in Boston. We met a team in California that had a very similar vision. And then we just decided to munge ourselves together into one new company versus competing.
Yeah. Can I ask how? How did you actually decide to join forces? And how was that discussion? You know, there's probably folks in the crowd here who, you know, probably at least two folks working on the same problem in this room. Or how do they munch like you guys did? How do they get that low bandwidth of communication? Or sorry, high bandwidth of communication?
So I met Stepan Pachika, who was the founder of the other team. And he's this brilliant, like, Russian-American entrepreneur, inventor. He had a team of people that Apple actually bought and brought over from Russia to make the Apple Newton. If anyone remembers, like, the Apple Newton, like, the original tablet, like, that was the team that made that, and they were still together. So he also had this, like, crew of people that had been together for, like, 20 years that high bandwidth communication. And I met him, and, you know, we compared notes, and we were like, man, we're really working on the same thing. Maybe we should do it together. So I flew out and had dinner with him in this really crappy sushi restaurant in Cupertino. And this is the first time we'd met face-to-face. And I remember he asked me, he's like, so, you know, it's almost like a mutual job interview. He's like, so what is your core competency? Like, what do you think you're best at? And I said, eating. Like, I'm best at eating. And he was like, oh, okay, like, what do you mean? Like, let's talk about that. And so we spent like 3 hours talking about food, about eating. We didn't discuss business at all. We didn't discuss Evernote. We were just talking about eating. And it was great. And we were like, yeah, we're like, we understand each other. We can have like a meaningful conversation about it. And then, yeah, everything else just kind of flowed from there. In hindsight, we should have maybe spent more time talking about the business, but whatever. The eating was good. But then, like, when we decided to put the companies together, that I actually think in hindsight was a pretty big mistake. It was very smart to work together, but if I had to do it over, I wouldn't like have tried to make a legal structure that merged these entities, because that added a ton of complexity, and it basically made us unfundable. Because until we had enough traction where it was worthwhile for investors to understand the non-conventional structure, like, no one would want to understand it. So like, what we should have done is just started from scratch. We should have just like, okay, let's just make a totally new company. You know, here are the people, let's like do it. But we didn't. We you know, try to preserve this structure and that structure. And so we like glued the two things together. And I would definitely recommend not doing that. Like, optimize for total simplicity, even if it means like throwing away the past stuff and just like starting from scratch. So like I definitely would have like worked with the same people, but I would have made an entirely new entity and probably saved 18 months of hassle.
Did you resolve that at one point, or did you end up going forward with fundraising on that same structure?
Yeah, I mean, it took a year and a half to clean up. So we did resolve it, but we basically resolved it by... So fundraising at Evernote in the beginning was atrociously hard. Very, really difficult. Like I wound up raising money in like Tartarstan, like where tartar sauce comes from. Like I went to, like seriously, Tartarstan. Does anyone know where Tartarstan is? I know some people here do. I didn't know either. Even though I'm like from Russia and it's in Russia. Because yeah, we were unfundable, but we did get it together. We were able to raise a round. But really what solved it is when we finally had enough traction where like it was okay. Like the complexity wasn't a big enough deal because people were like, yeah, like Evernote's really a thing. Then it became easy to clean everything up. But until we had it, you know, it was rough.
Evernote's got a long history of fundraising. You guys have raised approximately $350 million over the course of the business lifetime, and still kicking, doing great work right now. And I want to zoom into kind of the different stages of that. In the first stage, when you guys are, you know, just an idea, you guys have a great team, you know, it's fairly easy to come to investors and pitch, we have this vision, here's where we're going. You know, as you guys had developed some traction, you know, figured out your model a little bit more, you're pitching something different. You're then pitching, here's where we're going in, you know, 5 to 10 years, here's how we're going to make you rich. You guys have built a really, really robust, user base. People love the heck out of you. I love the heck out of you.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course. And I'm actually wondering, do we have any like power users of Evernote in the house? Like, yeah, we got some folks that love this stuff. Excellent. Excellent. And I wonder, you know, it's, I think, you know, not that it's easy, but it's a little bit easier to pitch, hey, we have a great user base that loves us. How did you pitch, we have a great user base that loves us that's gotten bigger, but we're not really quite making money off them yet. What did you pitch to investors then?
So all of Evernote fundraising is basically like, there's two parts. There's like there's one point that neatly splits it completely down the middle. There is all of the stuff in the beginning that was super hard. And then we figured out how to express it, and then it all became super easy. So we raised, yeah, a little over $350 million total. And I would say that like the first five was like 90% of the work. And like the rest of 340 was like 10% of the work that I barely had to do anything for. And the difference was like, we figured out like the way to talk about it. The specific, and like there's YouTube videos of like me explaining what the pitch deck was if anyone cares, but we basically figured out how to show the traction and like how, what it was building and why value was being created. There was this cohort analysis that I did that like became briefly well known, and that was it. And like literally everything before then, it was just like torture. And I don't think I had a single investor meeting after that didn't result in a term sheet, like literally. So it was just the importance of like crystallizing that story. Now, we couldn't have done it before we had the data, so it's not like we could have gotten there like much sooner, because like it wasn't just like a clever way of telling it. It was like we had the results, but even after we had the results, that wasn't sufficient. We needed the results plus like a really crisp way to describe why does the value accumulate. And once we had it, it became a lot easier for a long time. And then, you know, by the time we were very late stage, the market conditions totally changed, and then it became, would have been much harder to raise money. But hopefully, like luckily we'd raised so much that we just didn't need it. So we could sit out many years of, you know, bad market conditions.
Yeah. And, you know, in these early days of fundraising, I want to go back to the cohort analysis. But in these early days of fundraising, you know, you guys needed to raise money to basically support the engineering team. Fundraising also commits you to certain outcomes. How did you make that decision to say, we're going to make a venture-backed company, and we're going to get this to some sort of, you know, at least we're going to pitch some sort of liquidity outcome for our investors? How did you make that call?
So we had an explicit discussion about this in probably 2010, where we had just gotten to profitability for like 1 month. And we were like, okay, we could, like, this could be it. We don't really need any more money. So, you know, we would be growing slowly, but we could make something for like a relatively small number of people that was profitable or we could like raise a bunch more money and pursue a much bigger vision. Like, what should we do? And we really pretended to take that question seriously. Like, it was important that we like go through the motions of really going, what should we do? And then surprisingly, we decided, no, let's just make a giant thing and raise a bunch more money. You know, that's like, we had already made two companies in the past that were sort of, you know, moderate outcomes. So it was interesting to do something world changing. So we really like, we decided, yeah, we were going to go really big. So we raised a bunch more money. We didn't, we lost profitability. We then became unprofitable for like 5 years. So it was like a long period of like, of, you know, having to fund ourselves through investor money. Yeah, we just, that's what we wanted to do. If this wasn't the third time around, I think there would have been a much more serious question. And I do think that a lot of entrepreneurs like do make that mistake. Like, you don't have to go big. Like, you could, it's totally legitimate to just be like, I just want to make something, you know, modest and profitable. And I, in fact, like, I kind of like that model. We just, that wasn't what we wanted to do because it was already our third one.
Yeah, I think there's a famous quote of yours that says, you know, in conflict with the classic social network quote, $1 billion isn't cool, impacting 1 billion people is. So, well, you know,
you could have said that, yeah.
You read Inc. enough and they start making things up, but it sounds good, right? I would definitely take credit for it. There's a great story as well that I'd love to hear about in terms of your first fundraise. You know, it's 3 a.m., it doesn't look good. I wonder if you could take us to that moment.
Yeah, so because of the way that our financial structure was so complicated because we had like bunched these two companies together, it took a long time. And we finally got a term sheet for $10 million from this like European investor, which we were very happy with. And then we were in due diligence, and we were in due diligence for 6 months because like part of that due diligence, we had to clean up all of this like complicated structure. So 6 months of like due diligence. Meanwhile, like, we had a no shop clause, so we couldn't talk to other investors, and like we only had about 6 months of cash, so it was like kept being depleted. And it was supposed to close in sometime in 2008, and it was supposed to close on the day that Lehman Brothers went bankrupt, and the market lost like this giant amount of money. And the day before closing, the investor called me and was like, "We just lost 60% of our fund, and you know, we're pulling out. We can't invest." And we literally had 3 weeks of cash in the bank, and you know, we'd just spent 6 months with this investor, and they pulled out. We had like 20, 30 people already, 3 weeks of cash. So like, I, you know, spent a week calling every single like person I know, sending emails. Like, no one would even like return my emails. Like, the market was melting down. Sequoia had sent around the RIP good times memo, basically saying like, no one's ever going to invest money again. Like, it, like, my personal like net worth and stock portfolio was like, I was losing like 20% a day in like, you know, just like other stock and stuff. So it was just like, it was bad. So I spent a week trying to raise money and nothing happened. And then I had 2 weeks of cash in the bank and I decided I had to shut down the company. So this is like that story. So it was like 3 a.m. and I said, okay, I'm going to go to sleep now. I'm going to wake up tomorrow morning, go to the office and just tell everyone, like, lay everyone off and shut down the company because, you know, we only had 2 weeks left and you had to like pay your final bills and stuff. So you don't go to jail. And I decided to do it. I'm like, this is what's going to happen. Like, and I remember having the thought then that like, it was like, oh, this must be what being an adult feels like. Like, wow, this sucks. Like, I never want to be an adult again after this. And then like at 3 a.m., right before I turned off my computer, I got an email from some random Swedish guy. And the email was just like, hi, I'm some random Swedish guy. And, you know, I just want you to know that I love Evernote. Like, I've been using it for a few months and it's like totally changed my life and I'm much more productive. And I remember being like, oh, that's nice. Cause you know, like if you make one random Swedish guy happy, you've like done something. And so
sleep soundly that night.
Yeah, exactly. And then he just like ended the email by saying, oh, so I'm just wondering if you're looking for any investment. And I was like, yeah, yes, I am. And then I didn't go to sleep. And like I hit send and I like stayed up. And then like 20 minutes later, I like got in a Skype call with this guy. And then he sent us $500,000 like in 2 weeks. And it like totally saved the company because like that was like, that was what was needed to like we made that $500,000 last for like 6 months, And by then we actually had the traction and we figured out how to like talk about it. And then we were able to like raise money. But like, it was total luck. Like, this is not like, I didn't do anything other than like get super lucky. Like, I would have, had I gone to bed 5 minutes earlier, I wouldn't have even read that email in the morning. Like, I would have been like, must shut down the company. So yeah, like total and complete luck, but it worked out. And, you know, the main lesson from this is, you know, always answer emails from Swedes.
At 3 a.m.
If you're going to learn nothing else, yeah. So we did a convertible, you know, so we, and obviously, like, I told him everything. Well, look, we got 3 weeks of cash left, like, fully transparent. So he got a convertible note. I think he got, like, a 20% or 30% discount on the next round. So, he got a good deal. He did well, but he definitely didn't try to, like, you know, hold us hostage or anything for it. So, yeah, we just did a convertible on that. And it would have not been possible to price it, because how do you even price something like that, right? Like, yeah.
And so this is an incredible Hail Mary. And definitely congrats on
that. No, a Hail Mary is like intentional, right? You like intend to do a Hail Mary. This is like...
it's the football from the sky falling right into the arms.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm wondering, you know, there's obviously interesting case studies of folks like Elon who, you know, being totally screwed, dumped all of his own money into the company. Did you ever come to consider that?
Yeah, I mean, I put a lot of money into it. I mean, a lot, I did, Stefan did, we had a few like friends and family, like, you know, we definitely put a lot of money into it to get it to that point already.
Yeah. And, now that was the 5%, the really challenging 5%. Is that right? Of the 95% of fundraising that was
easy.
This was the hard
part. Yeah. That like after that, it became like, once we had the cohort stuff, we had the data, we had the cohort, we weren't like, it was good, but this was also the most fun part. Like, this is the other thing that I tell founders all the time. Like, a lot of my friends are raising money now, you know, they got startups. And it's like, man, this sucks. I'm like, yeah, it does. But raising money is by far the best part of running a company. Like, everything else is much harder. And like, you're going to look back and be like, oh man, I never had this much fun as when like trying to get the first round done, because you have such a clear fitness function, success function. It's like, you only have to do one thing, just like get some money. That's it. And you know, when you've done it, you're like, I only have to do this one thing. I know when I'm successful. It's an existential question. It's like live or die. And like, you never get that clarity afterwards. Because like, at some point, if your company survives long enough, there are no more like big existential problems. Like, you're not going to kill it. So then you show up to work every day and you're like, well, okay, so I did these 20 things, but were these the best 20 things you could do? Like, none of them saved the company. So like, yeah, like the most fun, like, yeah, if you're raising money now and you think that's hard, it's like, it's great. Just enjoy it. Like, it gets a lot less clear afterwards.
Yeah, sure. And in terms of this cohort analysis, I really want to zoom into that. I think sort of modeling your company, like intellectually onto a page, is some of the most important work that the CEO can do. And I want to introduce the folks here to what that is. What is this cohort analysis that you're talking about?
Well, I mean, I don't want to like describe graphs. You should just look at it. But the basic idea is what we showed was it was a three-slide, three-graph business model. The first graph just showed what our growth rate was, and we just said, "Look, here's like totally organically how many users we're adding," and you know, it looked like a good up and to the right graph that everyone's
classic
got.
Hockey stick, yeah.
Everyone's got one of those. Yeah. It actually wasn't a hockey stick because it was pretty linear, but it was good. And then the second one was the retention rate over time, and that was really cool. It looked like a smile. So like, people dropped off and then it flattened out and then they came back. We call that the spiral graph. And that was already kind of unique because we showed that actually we're not just bleeding users forever. Like, we, like, people who have been around Evernote for a few months, like, they stick around. And then the third one was we showed how likely you were to pay, to convert to paying by cohort age. So like, if you used it for 1 month, how likely for 2 months and so on. And that also went up linearly. So, I don't know what the numbers are now, but back then, and for a long time, this stayed constant. In the first month, only about 0.5% of users paid. So like, if you sign up for Evernote, you know, because you can get everything for free, only about 0.5% of people decided to pay in the first month. But after a year, it was like 5%. So people who had been there for a year were like 5 to 6% likely to pay. And after 2 years, it was like 11%. And, you know, by the time we had 4 or 5 years of data, like the oldest cohorts, they were like 30, 40%. And so like the more, like the longer you stay, the more likely you were to pay. And then when you like multiply those three graphs together, you have this like really nice looking hockey stick. And that was, we just sort of walked people through it. And obviously we didn't have 4 years of data, but even like 6 months of data was enough because you could see the trends and we could like, look, like, you know, as long as people keep sticking around, and they are, and this holds up, like here's how many trillions of dollars of money we'll make in the long term. So we started calling it long-term greedy. Like we don't want to be short-term greedy, we want to be long-term greedy. We want to be like, we want to look at an Evernote user and say like, I've got the rest of your life to make money from you. Like as long as I can keep you, as long as I keep giving you value for the rest of your life, like I can just make more and more money. So I don't have to like squeeze money out now, I should just like make you want to come back. And that was compelling. Like we did it in a compelling way, and you can see the presentations all over the place, I think. I haven't Googled it in a while. And it worked. It worked really well. But of course, like we needed the data. Like I've had lots of people afterwards come and be like, oh, we did like the same thing, but it doesn't work for us. I'm like, right, because your data shows that it's not true. Like it isn't that if you use this graph type, people give you money. It's like you also need the performance.
And so strategically speaking, obviously Evernote had a huge success in organic growth, word of mouth, especially sort of in major cities and eventually making its way to Asia. Do you guys do anything in terms of customer acquisition that helped grow that graph? Referral programs, that kind of thing? Maybe things that these folks could take home and try with their businesses?
Yeah, so we actually never got good at paid acquisition. I mean, now we are. After I left, there was a team that knows what they're doing with that. But we never really did any advertising. We did some experiments, but we never were good at paying for users. So all of our users were free, came to us unpaid. Which, like, it sounds like I'm bragging about this, you know, and I am, but it's actually like that's actually a weakness. Like, what it really means is, we didn't know how to pay for users. Like it would have been a much stronger business had we had that, plus the experience of how do you pay for users, because then you can really make it scalable. And so like, I don't want to make that sound like that should be something you're going for. Like it would be even better if we could pay for users. Well, we just didn't have the skill set. Now the company has that skill set. But yeah, so they were all free. It was all word of mouth. We weren't viral because we didn't have any like viral loops. Like you didn't use Evernote until the very end. There was no like using Evernote with other people. You just like, you told other people about it because you really liked it, but so like you used it with them. And we ignored all of the conventional wisdom about localizing it. So like we didn't, it was exactly the same version of Evernote more or less in just like every country. And there was no difference between how people used it in China and how people used it in Turkey and how people used it in the US. We just like made the same product, and we just tried to make a product that was so good that it would transcend local tastes. And you know, for the most part, like that was successful.
And on that note of sort of running this business internationally, I know you've got some interesting learnings, having spent a bunch of time in Japan, having interesting lessons from there. What was that decision to expand internationally like? Did you pull the switch and say, now we're available in Asia? Or was it more of a deliberate rollout per country basis, you know, ignoring localization, kind of doing anything locally?
So I wanted it to be global right away. And in particular, I wanted to go to Japan. Like I love Japan. I have for many, many years. I was like, a bunch of us at Evernote really love Japan. So we were just looking for an excuse to go to Japan. So like at one point, like really early on in the process, I remember it was me and Alex, and we were like staring at the graphs by country. Because, you know, we had users everywhere just because we weren't preventing people from Japan from using it. We were only in English. And we were looking at the graphs, and I was like, I think I see a little spike from Japan. And I was like, where? And I'm like right there? Like, maybe that's a spike? And he's like, yeah, that looks like a spike. Like, I think we need to figure out what's going on over there. He's like, I think we do too. So we like booked a plane ticket and like went to Japan. And then just like met with a bunch of bloggers. We're like, so why are people using us in Japan? But it turned out there was like a few bloggers that had written about us. And so we met with them and we like went to dinner and had drinks. And Japan is this amazing place. Like it's one of my favorite places in the world. But there's a quality about it, which is great, which is Japan is like, everyone in Japan is a nerd about something. Like every person in Japan meets the classical definition of nerd, which is they know way more than they should about something. And they're like really passionate about it. Like not necessarily about computers or something, but like everyone is like super passionate about something which they're like almost obsessed about. And Evernote is for those people, right? And so like when you have a whole country where like every single person in the country is like the ideal user, it's great. And there's another quality there, which is like it's a very, there's a very infectious, like positive reinforcement cycle in Japan. And this is actually true in most places in the world, but like we would go there and we would be really excited to be in Japan because Japan is awesome. And we'd be with, you know, Japanese people, bloggers, reporters, and they would be like super excited because we were visibly excited. And then we would get even more excited because like our Japanese friends were like super excited. And then they would like get more excited because we were excited. And the whole thing would just like spiral into this just like ball of like everyone being excited. And then like before you know it, there'd be like millions of users and press conferences and investment and partnership. And it was all just because like we showed up and we loved it. And we like visibly loved it. And a version of that worked in every country, but it like it got turbocharged in Japan. And then there's like another 20 things about Japan that are like super magical and great and like inspired Evernote in many ways.
Great. A good follow-up question to ask you for that. So far, you know, you've got this huge user base, international user base, you know, trending towards monetization. There is a lever to pull with monetization. What was the discussion that you guys had seriously about how you're going to make money off this product?
So we had monetization in the product from day one. Like when we launched Evernote into, you know, in open beta, which was in like June of 2008, we already had monetization. We already had a premium version that was $5 a month. And we like picked the price at random and then didn't change it for like 6 years. And so there was already something you could pay for. And that was actually super important. Like we didn't wait for monetization. We could get revenue from day one. And that was important because that's how we got that cohort data. Because like already, like right from the beginning, some people were starting to pay and we could look at those rates and ask them why they were paying and all of that kind of stuff. So we always had it right from the beginning. We would decide when to prioritize it. So like what features would we make free? What features would we make paid? How much would it be? Like all of that stuff we decided later. And the way that I saw it was, look, our goal is to get to 1 billion people like using Evernote and loving it and being more productive. Like we want to impact the world. And we need some money to do that. And that money can come from revenue. Money can come from investment. The money can come from revenue from consumers or from companies, or it can come from investors. And the question is just like, which of those is more expensive to us? Because they're all expensive, right? It's not like you think that like, oh, well, like, okay, investment is expensive because you give up equity, but revenue is also expensive because then you have to like work on things that people pay for. And so that's just a question of like, which is the cheapest way to fund it? And for a while, investment was very, very easy. And so we were like, okay, we definitely need to have some revenue because we need to keep showing how it grows and we need to understand it. But it's actually easy to get money relatively inexpensively. So we should just do that until that's no longer true. And, you know, then it tips over and then revenue becomes, you know, more important. So that's kind of the analysis we had. And we would actually, you know, like probably around 2014, it tipped over where like, okay, we really do like, we shouldn't keep raising money from the market. We really need to get it to profitability. Luckily we had raised enough at that point where even though like the late stage venture market got really bad at that point, we didn't need any more. We had enough. And then the new management team has actually been able to take it to sustainable profitability as far as I know.
You end up joining General Catalyst, great investment firm. And it seems like, you know, that hopefully is something that's fun to you. I want to ask, you know, I think a lot of VCs will give, here's what my most interesting trends are. And I think that, you know, you have addressed it well yourself, that tends to have people chasing things that in 2 years will no longer really be relevant by the time that their company's interesting. So instead, I want to ask about your thesis. How do you examine companies and people that run them?
So there's what I look for, but then there's like what I would do if I was starting another company. Mm-hmm. So I think, like what I would do if I was starting a company is I would pick something that that I thought I could build like this year and like actually have real people find value out of it and like pay for it and like something very practical that would have been impossible to build like even 3 years earlier. Like that's the timing trick. It's like find an important problem just as it's gone from being literally impossible to like merely hard. And then make it is like, and if you get that right, like that's that's kind of magic. If you get it wrong on either end, it's bad, because if you like, if you work on a, you know, if you work on a problem that's not an important problem, then you're just wasting your time. If you work on an important problem but it's still impossible, you're unlikely to succeed because it's impossible. If you work on an important problem that like used to be impossible but now it's actually pretty easy, then you're probably way too late and there's like way more competition. So like the trick is like find something that you couldn't have really solved a few years ago, but now you can totally solve. And that's why it's like, I think it's dangerous to think about like a particular like area, a particular theme, because like if I say what I'm interested in now as an investor, and like people go and start that thing, like that timing is probably off. By the time they get to me, it's probably, you know, it's probably too late. But that's how I would look at it.
My last question is, now an investor, you've run Evernote. Would you have invested in Evernote after the cohort analysis?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I did. Like I put my own money into Evernote before and after, and it was like one of the better investments I made. So, yeah.
Yeah. Please give him a hand. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
So we are in partnership with Slido, an excellent company that helps us with doing questions. We thought we would, for either the investor or the founder side, throw a few questions at Phil. So if you have a question that you'd like to have us read off here and have Phil answer, you know, just go to Slido and just type in startup round, capitals don't matter, and you can just throw up things up here. So we thought we'd start with, what's your favorite entrepreneurial advice that you were given that you live by?
The greatest hits was definitely like the Steve Ballmer thing about like just having your, you know, your crew, your 100 people and knowing who they are. I sort of reduce that to, I get into a lot of trouble every time I say it, but it doesn't matter. Don't bother making friends with people who you wouldn't start a company with. Just like, can't afford the slots. So that's how I've internalized it. There's a few others. So the Mikitani-san, who's the one of the only people I know who actually was the CEO when the company was one person and still the CEO, and now there's companies 30,000 people, is company CEO of Rakuten, which is a big Japanese tech company. And he said that every time you triple in size, everything breaks. That was like super true. And so, yeah, every time you like triple in size in terms of like revenue, number of products, number of employees, amount of funding raised, like every tripling, everything breaks, like everything. And so just like celebrate that, anticipate it, like don't get caught running with systems and processes that you put in place like two triplings ago. And quickly growing startups that go through multiple triplings of various things every year. So that's been super useful.
We've got more folks looking to learn about you as an investor. Is there anything you want to add to your thesis? What are you looking for in the companies and people you invest in?
I'm sorry, I was focusing on the, does the Swedish guy really exist? And
I want to restart that.
So yes, he really exists, because otherwise I'd be a liar, and I'm not. So he obviously is a real person. I've asked him several times if he wants to like, if he wants me to say who he is, if he wants like press or something, and he doesn't. So he's asked to remain anonymous. That may be more to do for like Swedish tax reasons than anything else. I'm not sure. Or modesty, let's say modesty. But he's a super good guy. I actually met him in person for the first time like 5 years after he invested. So I'd obviously talked to him a lot on like Skype and stuff, but I did get to meet him in person and toured him and his family around the Evernote office, and it was great. He never worked for the company. He was an investor. I don't know if he's still a shareholder. He did sell at least something in one of the secondaries we did, and I think he did pretty well. But yeah, I'm super grateful. Great guy. Should hit him up next time I'm doing something.
So besides the Swedish investor, what are you personally looking for in these people and companies that you're investing in? And maybe some that you've already invested in that tipped you over the edge when you learned that about that team.
So the main thing I look for, so I think of everything in like sci-fi terms. The main thing that I look for in a founder is I want someone that can articulate really crisply, what does the world look like if your company is massively successful? which very few people can do. It's like, it's actually, it seems like a simple thing, but most people don't think through like what happens to the world if I succeed, if this company succeeds beyond my wildest dreams. So I want someone that can explain that to me. Like, I know what it looks like if you fail, it looks the same. What does it look like if you succeed spectacularly? And that should be a world that I want to live in, that I prefer to the current world. Probably 99% of people can't, like, don't get there. Like, they don't, it's not how they thought about it, but I'll often ask explicitly. So that's the main thing. Like, tell me what the world looks like and tell me why I should prefer that world to the current one. And I don't mean that, like, oh, the world looks like, well, I'll have a lot more money. Like, that isn't, like, yes, I do prefer that. Everything else being equal, I would prefer to have a lot more money. But that's not what I mean.
And you guys had a pretty complicated structure at Evernote. I was wondering, as are these guys, how did you decide to divide up equity and the roles at Evernote?
So the original teams that we came together, we just sort of divided what we thought, you know, would happen. And then from going forward, we just had this normal, you know, employee stock option pools and all that stuff. And then roles were, that actually, you know, you'd think that'd be hard, but it really wasn't. Like, Stefan and I decided that I would be the CEO. And then, you know, other people changed roles quite a bit. That turned out not to be a big deal at all.
Yeah, and if everything else fails, I read a quote from you, modesty being the best virtue, that you are the least proficient coder, so you had to become the manager.
Yeah, when we started Engine 5, my first company, so there was originally going to be five of us, but then two people chickened out, so there was only three, but we already registered the URL, so it was like Engine 5, and we stuck with the name. And we were all engineers, and we literally didn't know that there was such a thing called investors. Like, nobody told us that other people would give us money. So we're like, in the first company, we had no investors. We were just profitable from day one. A lot of consulting revenue, which, you know, sucks. All of us were coders, but my other two co-founders were like super coders. They were like the 10X engineers, and I wasn't. I had to like buy a sports jacket and go see customers, and that's how I became the CEO. And then they never challenged it. And that was the thing. It was like for years. Like, so I was CEO for 19 years. Between the three companies, I was CEO for 19 years. And I always felt like a fraud. Like, I always felt that someone at some point is going to be like, wait a minute. Like, why are you the CEO? And like, no one ever said that. But it was for 19 years, I felt like I'm a fraud. And I actually think that's like pretty common. I think, like, in hindsight, I think like, most competent people feel that way. And there's actually research about this, about how like people who are actually good at their job, like they kind of underestimate how good they are, and people who actually suck usually overestimate. Which makes sense because like among the things they suck at is actually estimation. So I kind of think most like really good people feel like a fraud at least part of the time. And so if you don't, if you're like sitting around being like, yeah, I am the best person for this job, like.
Good advice to take home. There's a question that's, what would you say to the world in 5 seconds? But I think that's a good answer. I want to finish on this question, which is not what's your favorite startup, but, Evernote is a productivity tool used all over the world. And you guys would be the answer to this question. In fact, for Inc., you were the company of the year for 2011. So you were the answer to this question. Tools, software, startups that you just can't live without these days?
That I can't live without these days?
That's right.
Yeah, so it's still Evernote for me. Slack, definitely like rocketed into that space. Like everything I'm doing now is in Slack. Uber, for better or for worse. Like, obviously, like San Francisco would basically be unlivable without something like that. The thing that no one has solved yet that I really want someone to finally get around to is email. Like, email is still the worst thing in the universe, and it's just getting worse and worse and worse. I'm definitely interested in somebody finally doing something. I don't know what you could do. Probably Slack and Uber are the two. And with Uber, I recognize that that's not 100% of a positive thing, but very high impact.
And anything you want to talk about in terms of Uber? We can kind of go into that culture a little bit. The culture you built at Evernote was obviously one that had, high bandwidth communication, good culture there. Is there anything that Uber could have done differently?
Yeah, I mean, it's way above my pay grade to like give advice to Uber. They've obviously built something that's like fundamentally important and world changing. And I really believe that on balance, the world is better off because Uber's in it. Obviously, they're having, you know, they're having a bad time, you know, culturally, and I don't know it that well. I actually used to know Travis reasonably well. We sort of came up roughly the same time. But I haven't, you know, and I personally always thought he was a great guy, but I don't know how well I actually know him. I haven't like talked to him in a few years, and maybe it's different. But you know, Uber's built something much more consequential than anything I've done, and yeah, I don't really have advice to give them other than, I guess, you know, try.
Good advice to all of us. Please give Phil a hand. Thanks a lot, guys.